Well, I guess Latourian is better than Latourist or something like that. And thank you very much for CRASSH to invite me. The other talk at CRASSH tonight, the alternative was a talk on tap dancing, I'm told. And I'm sure lots of you would much prefer to be in the tap dancing lecture than in this one about understanding society. I'm going to make two detours for this project, Understanding Society. One of them is to say we might have to take into account what I will call an explainative lecture, modes of existence. But what I'll make a second detour because I wanted to present the digital version, and as usual with digital stuff, it's not ready. So I have nothing to show. I wanted to present a PowerPoint with all the little goodies that we would have in our digital humanities project, and you, I'm sorry to say, see none of that. So instead of a digital version, I made a little detour for the biography, not of myself, which would be of no interest, but of the inquiry, the investigation itself. And that's what I'm going to talk to you tonight. The inquiry as a genre, as a distinguished pedigree in philosophy. But it's quite unusual that you do a book which is called The Inquiry into Mode of Existence, and you try for digital system plus mediators to associate people who are called co-investigator in the way the argument will go, which I will do starting with the English version in April all the way to the end of 1914. The co-investigator, that is maybe some of you after the lecture, or maybe none of you after the lecture, we will see, are invited to be attentive to this expression of modes of existence, which I took from a very strange book by Étienne Souriau, which I have republished recently. The banal and quasi-ecological expression of mode of existence refers to, in a way, a specific speech act, each with its peculiar felicity and infelicity condition, to use Austin's famous expression, to which is added, that's a difficulty, the claim that a highly specific type of world is also being inhabited. Souriau's claim is not to say that there are several ways to talk about one world, but several ways for the world in the plural to be addressed. The use of this mode is what allows me to offer to the modern, a term obviously too vast, but the inquiry will specify it, a more realistic description than the one presenting the advent of Western reason or the one authorized by the critique of that same reason. My hypothesis is that each of these modes make it possible to respect, in the empirical areas I've pursued up to now, a certain tonality in experience, the felicity of infelicity condition particular to each case, and especially, that's where things become really tricky, a specific ontology. In fact, each mode requires us to encounter distinct being that must be addressed in their own singular languages. The classic question of philosophy, what is the essence of technology, science, religion, and so on, then becomes what are the beings appropriate to technology, science, religion, and how have the moderns tried to approach them? But how can the multiplication of these modes be justified when the civilization that once tried to study us is based on only two categories, subject and object, though in many different combinations. When readers fail to understand why I've continually changed fields, and when they do not see the overall logic of my research, it's because I was doing this inquiry all along, quite obsessively, maybe madly, for more than 25 years. If I'm going to go back to the past, the conscious past, I leave aside the unconscious, we shall have to begin with a convergence between Charles Peguy and Rudolf Bultmann, two people probably most of you don't know. Every September, despite the harvest that was so important in the wine trade of my family, my parents used to take me on a pilgrimage to Orléans for the annual Peguy Fest. If I was deeply influenced by reading Peggy, Peggy is the greatest French writer for the end of the 19th century, Clio especially, it must have been because I conflated the lessons of Clio, the muse, that great master of hermeneutic, with the meticulous, maniacal, and fertile scholarship of biblical exegesis. From 1966 to 1973, when I was a militant Catholic student at the University of Dijon, I had the good fortune to have as a philosophy professor André Malet, a Protestant minister, and Rudolf Bultmann's first French translator. In his hands, the biblical text finally becomes comprehensible to the poor Catholic I was, revealed as a lengthy process of transformation, invention, glosses, and diverse rationalization, which is a term Bultmann preferred, which taken together sketched out the layers of interpretation that played out, this is the essential point, each in its own way, the question of fidelity and treason. Faithful or falsified invention, impious reworking or astonishing rediscovery. We spent hours outside of class comparing the various narratives about the resurrection. Should they be read as informational stories, the tomb is really empty, or as transformational story? The angel with a raised finger makes it clear to the women coming to the tomb this Easter day how the scriptures are to be read. And how do such stories manage to resuscitate the persons to whom they are addressed? Because they escaped, in my eyes, from an inexplicable form of transcendence and immobility, because they became localized, historical, situated, artificial, yes, invented, reinvented, because they raise the question of their own veracity at every turn, this text finally became for us active and accessible. The crushing responsibility of a reader, invoked so marvelously in Clio of Peggy, was given a scholarly definition by Bultmann. So strangely, to my eyes, the systematic deconstruction by exegesis of all dogmatic certitude, far from weakening the true value that the successive glosses played out over and over, made it possible at last to raise the question of religious truth, but only on condition of acknowledging that there was an itinerary of varied diction with its own felicity condition, an itinerary of which traces remain in exegesis. In a thesis defended in 1975, quickly forgotten, I developed this argument in an analysis of Mark's Gospel and of Peggy, plus a bit of Derrida thrown in, but we can't forget. According to my analysis, if the text on the empty tomb did not convey information, they did something much more significant by indicating the possibility of regime of truth which are veridical and verifiable. What is certain is that I emerged from that formative period armed with a complete confidence about the fact that the more a layer of text is interpreted, transformed, taken up anew, stitched back together, replayed, rewoven, each time in a different way, the more likely it is to manifest the truth it contains. On condition, this is the part I gathered and I kept until today, that one knows how to distinguish it from a different mode of truth, pure and perfect information, which I didn't yet call double-click information, since computer mice had not tickled our finger at the time. A long struggle against the eradication of mediation among modern was about to begin, and I've done that all the way to iconoclash a few years back. Since it was still possible to escape from military service by engaging in cooperation, a sort of peace corps, I left the lycée where I was teaching for Abidjan in Ivory Coast. Imagine the brainwashing in store for a provincial bourgeois Catholic with an advanced degree in philosophy who finds himself transported into the cauldron of neocolonial Africa with his wife and child. In the Abidjan of 1973, I discovered all at once the most predatory forms of capitalism, the method of ethnography, and the puzzles of anthropology. One of them has never left me. Why do we use the notion of modernity, the modernizing frontier, the arrow of time, the contrast between modern and pre-modern, before we even apply to those who call themselves civilizer or modernizer the same method of investigation that we apply to the others? Those whom we claim, at least we used to claim that in 73, no longer, if not to civilize them entirely, at least to modernize them a little bit. By good fortune, the field study proposed to me by my colleagues dealt with factories in Ivory Coast and the impossible question of, I don't know how to translate that, ivoirisé, ivorizing the executive, question which is still exists in Ivory Coast today. Why did the expatriate, this was the question I was asked, bosses find no African executive competent enough to replace them? I felt right away that if to answer this question I were to use the schema of a struggle between modernization and archaism, I would not be able to understand anything. But I realized at the same time that there was no alternative scheme, since we did not know how to describe in ethnographic terms the meanings of rational, effective, competent, and profitable. All quality, I was told with the scornful assurance of expatriate, that seemed to be lacking in the African executive. I saw clearly that these adjectives of combat and conquest did not result from any independent description. They were slogans, battle cries. If people hastened to invoke cultural dimension, cognitive limits, black souls, and African mentality, it was because their definition for the work of thought were not sufficiently material and concrete. There was a flagrant asymmetry here. The whites anthropologized the black, yes, quite well, but they avoided anthropologizing themselves. Or they did so in a falsely distant, exotizing fashion, by focusing on the most archaic aspect of their own society. Festival, astrological belief, First Communion, that sort of thing. And not on what I was seeing with my own eyes, educated, it's true, by a collective reading of L'Anti-Oedipe, was all the craze at the time. In other words, everything that makes up the structural heart of the expanding empire was not the object of ethnographic description. From this arose the idea of applying the method of the social sciences, ethnography in particular, to the most modernizing practices. In 1975, California seemed to be at the forefront of humanity's advancement, even described as its target tracking missile. This was before the two Bushes and Reagan and many other people. A scientist friend from Dijon, Roger Guillemin, a Nobel Prize in biology, had suggested that I join him at the newly established Salk Institute in San Diego, if only I could kind of come up with a funding. It took me, I'm sorry to say, only a few pages to write up the project of an anthropology that would provide an ethnographically based description of those who call themselves rational, scientific, and modern. I still remember the astonished look of a consular agent who was to rubber stamp on my Fulbright grant application when he heard my confident claim that I was going to make anthropology symmetrical at last. And I did it. But imagine my amazement when he discovered in Guillemin's laboratory in 1975, in the splendid Louis Kahn's building overlooking the Pacific Ocean, that scientific work bore a strange resemblance to the exegesis I believed I'd left behind. As a good ethnographer, I knew that I should be skeptical of the abstract notion of ideas floating in the air. But I did not imagine that following the inscription, Derrida again, all the ideography of instrument would provide such a fertile ground. And yet, everything in the mysterious fabrication of facts became clear once we undertook, with my colleagues in science studies, to focus on the documents in the researcher in which, in white lab coat, showed such interest, a strange interest, totally casual and obsessive on one hand. And when I want to follow the transformation of his document step by step, it was as though the sciences could be embodied in fragile and apparently impalpable intellectual technologies. How could that form of materiality, the inscription, have disappeared from the epistemology, the official philosophy of science, as completely, I thought, as biblical exegesis had disappeared from the preaching of Christian church, especially Catholic dogma? How could one explain that here too, the appeal to an abusive transcendence had been able to dissimulate the layers of text, of document, that had to be continuously rewoven in order to produce a truth that could not be based, try as you might, on a firmer foundation? Was it possible that scientific verdiction was as far away from double-click information as the latter is from religious truth-making? In which case, we would find ourselves faced with three types of verdiction, each entirely distinct from the others, and true in its own genre and its own fashion. In San Diego, I fell into the habit of bringing the smartest people I met around in the laboratory where I was working. I was a terrible lab worker, by the way. I hoped they would shed their wisdom on the enigma of an anthropology of science. As luck would have it, just when I was asking my difficult question, I made the acquaintances of semiotics, Gramscian version, thanks to Paolo Fabri, which great semiotician of Italy. I still recall my admiration when Fabri, with his high-pitched voice and his lovely Italian accent, picked up a text that had emerged from the lab machinery, classical text full of diagrams, now famous, about TRF, a peptide, neuropeptide, and calmly set out to produce a Gramscian analysis of it, as if he were dealing with a fairy tale. In Paolo's capable hands, the varied figuration of actors was no longer to be confused with the underlying detection of actants. That's the first time I heard the word. I suddenly understood that the non-human character had their own adventure that we could track so long as we abandoned the illusion that they were ontologically different from the human character. The only thing that counted was their agency, their power to act, and the diverse figuration that we are given. A world opened up that I have not finished exploring, and that lends itself admirably, I have to say, to the principle of comparative or symmetric anthropology. Collectives, which is the word I use not to use the word social and society, in spite of a lecture series title, were distinguished by the figuration they gave to actants, through the trial they had put their characters through, but not at all because some of these were realistic, rational, while others would be symbolic, imagined, or mythical. The powers of semiotics derive precisely from its radical indifference to the obvious realism of subject and social actors. I had found the ideal condition for tracing the inventiveness of sciences that had been crushed in a way by the task of mimicking the word, derailed by being so often confused with information, double click, about pitiful matters of fact devoided of their matters of concern. Only the semiotics of scientific writings and inscription, freed from ordinary realism, that's the point, could deploy this totally original mode of reference. My excitement will not be hard to understand I had a strong sense that this phenomenon, the circulation of scientific truth along chains of inscription, would not have an easy time in philosophy. And many years later, I'm still working at it. But the passion for semiotics, which cuts its teeth as much on biblical text as on literary fiction, might have led to a simple textualization or deconstruction of scholarly activity. If I had not the chance of discovering in Harold Garfinkel's research around the same time, an entirely different way of breaking with the social realism that was so widespread in sociology and still is. The odd jargon-laden genius of ethnomethodology comes from a discovery that every course of action, even the most ordinary one, like giving a lecture, I could fall dead in a minute, is constantly interrupted by a minuscule hiatus that requires, from moment to moment, an inventive act of repossession by the actor equipped with his own micro-method, to use a word of Garfinkel. A clumsy lab worker myself, I unintentionally multiplied experiences of breaching, this is the word Garfinkel proposed, to reveal the hiatus, but revealed by contrast the hard-won competence of my comrades scientists in the laboratory. I was, of course, put off by Garfinkel's style, but I understood that he was proposing to do for all accounts, another of this word, what I had already identified in religious exegesis and what I was discovering on the lab bench in the exegesis of scientific text. No continuity of a course of action is possible without at any point an inventive repossession that gives the social actors reflexive capabilities, sources of innovation, and even sociologies and ontology. Garfinkel would not have liked the word, who go far beyond the capacity of the observer. The investigatee always know, I learned there, a great deal more than the investigator. This is why I still found the philosophy of my youth so indispensable. I mean the continental philosophy, not the sort of thing you do here. It alone was untamed enough to manage to follow without too much astonishment the inventiveness of agents. It was through metaphysics that one could hope to become a good ethnographer. The idea that actors need no longer be viewed as cultural dopes, this is the famous expression from Garfinkel, resonated marvelously with the accent deployed by semiotics. Happily protected by my raw ignorance of sociology, I could not know that Garfinkel was going to remain as completely unassimilable by the social scientist as Grémas was by epistemologists. Thus, nothing prevented me from using the term social and even social construction to describe the adventures of a non-human being that were beginning to populate collective. I had no way of knowing that it would take me a quarter of a century to get rid of the complication associated with the word social. It was thanks to Michel Calon that I was introduced to industrial field study, that the fourth mode. As we saw things, the technological arrangement we had to trace from the standpoint of innovation was very fashionable at the time, presented a form of realism, again another realism, that the notion of efficiency and profitability could not exhaust. In the course of our investigation, we reconstructed the way engineers had so designed an entire world in order to succeed in maintaining their riskiest innovation just a little bit longer. Here again, I fell upon a course of action that no continuity, no transport of necessity, no somewhat solid causality could explain. But the hiatus peculiar to new technologies was astonishing, because in the end, what everything was in place, when the arrangement was already working, the technique, the detour of the technique, appeared as another mode of existence. This was the first time I heard the term, which had been proposed and explored by someone some of you might know, Gilbert Simondon, one of the few philosophers of technology. So just as science, grasped in their practice, could not be contained within the narrow framework of epistemology, neither could techniques, especially the most advanced, the most modern one, be contained within the simple idea of effective action on matter. They had to do with magic, kinship, religion, philosophy. They had their own world full of organization, negotiation, calculation, metaphysics, and even morality. They represented, and still do, a complete challenge to ethnography or sociological description in that they upset the border, separated the human from non-human actors. But in addition, and more radically, they populated the collective or non-human actor with completely unintended consequence. The technical infrastructure was, or so it seemed to Calon, John Law, and all the people in science study, the most social element in a given society. Provided that we return to the etymology of the adjective, and that's my way to understand society, and enable themselves to follow all the association required to extend the network, especially if we added to it the intellectual technology that we had learned to follow by studying laboratories. To machine, we had to add officers. To gears and cogs, we had to add accounting techniques. To the resistance of material, we had to add standardization, the raw. And yet, in the eyes of our colleague, this shift from social to association seemed to be not legitimate. The social did not seem capable, in their hands, of absorbing the multiple and labile connection that we had designated by the word association. The discovery of technical detours and delegation added thus to my list a new mode whose ontology was very inadequately accounted for by the notion of materiality. I was beginning to wonder whether I might not have to change entirely the metaphysics I had been trained in, when I was lucky enough, as you know, as a researcher, luck is very important, to get a phone call from an anthropologist in California with an invitation to attend the first meeting of specialists in Papio Anubis, baboons in other words, which were beginning to be studied systematically. Believe me, there are lots of baboonologists, some of them here. She needed an observer of controversy among scientists, and controversy there were a lot in this field. 35 years later, the shock of my encounter with Shirley Strum and later with Donna Haraway, along with primatology, ethnology, and etology, and the Kenyan savannah, and above all, monkeys, has not faded. I was to discover, first of all, that an intense social life, that of a baboon's troop that Shirley had been following for 7 years while I met her, she's still studying them in 2012. This is the longest social group ever studied, was perfectly compatible with an extremely limited use of technical tools. While baboons manifest an unimaginable degree of social complexity, worthy of Garfinkel, they still use only their brains and their body. Here was something that offered a fine confirmation of the intuition Calon and the others had about the technology, the technical fabrication of society. What characterized human is not the emergence of a social, but the detour, translation, and folding of all courses of action into more and more complicated, not necessarily more complex, technical arrangement. And this is where we wrote with Calon the first argument around the actor network theory, which became a bit infamous, but still there. In shifting from a social to association, the analyst benefited at last from as much freedom to maneuver as informants had. This was our ethical necessity. We could break out of a narrow framework of social dimension of scientific or technical phenomena whose content at the time was presumed to escape the analyst entirely. The expanding socio-technical network, this is the slogan of the time, were the one to follow. And we say that in many, many ways, a bit too strongly. We were young, but we were right also. And we were well prepared for what's going to follow, the ecological crisis where human and non-human are associated. And yet, it was not the invention of a sociology of translation that was so important in my long association with Shirley and the ethologist. It was the discovery that another mode, totally surprising to me, of letting organism to their own devices. I knew laboratories. I began to measure the artificial, in the good sense of the word, of experiment. I knew perfectly well that there was nothing natural in nature. But how was I to qualify the space created by baboon's troop followed by the researchers? As we followed the baboons on foot, surely, this is a very strange thing when you follow these ethologists, as invisible in their midst as Athena at the heart of a battle, speaking softly, explained the astonishing complexity of their societies while taking notes. I began to imagine other relation, this is a more philosophical point, between the courses of action of knowledge and the courses of action of some of the elements of a known world. But to get that, I needed the opportunity to acquaint myself with the other metaphysics, that of William James and your great philosopher, Whitehead. It is from Trinity, I understand. It is to Isabel Stengers, a great philosopher from Belgium, whom I had known since 1978, that I owe the constant disruption that she imposed on all the social explanation that we use at the time, even those improved by actor network theory. She challenged all my socio-semiotic development with a vigorous, I know, but yet. Je sais, mais quand même. And making a characteristic rapid circular movement with her right hand, for those of you, this is a Stengersian gesture, something that would be the word had to be grasped differently. Even my microbes from Pasteur, even my Aramis subway, even Michel Calon's famous scallops, all of them undeniably present, acting, moving, glittering with reality, still did not offer, in Stengers' eye, a sufficient guarantee that we had pulled ourselves away from the text, social, symbolic, nature, resources, which is the way to understand society normally. To manage that, we would have to grasp the world, English is strange, without dragging through it human subject and their obsession with knowledge conceived as the relation between words and things. How can we move to a post-epistemological definition of the very word understanding society? I'm almost certain that it was in 1987, during a conversation by the swimming pool at Fondation Les Treilles in Provence, that Stengers shared with me an astonishing quote from Whitehead, who was even less well known at the time than Gabriel Tard, about the risk taken by rocks. Yes, rocks. In order to keep on existing. This is the philosophical part of his anthropological talk. It must have been the famous passage about Cleopatra's needle on the Charing Cross embankment in The Concept of Nature, not a book to read for fun. In August of that year, stretched out in the sun on an island across Gothenburg in Sweden, I couldn't stop running my finger over the rough red surface of a rock, as if to ask them to give me the answer to Whitehead. Could Whitehead have been right? At that moment, everything what I discovered in Kenya and what the principle of irréduction had hinted at obscurely became clear. there exists a completely autonomous mode of existence that is very inadequately encompassed by the notion of nature, material world, exteriority, or object, precisely the one on which Whitehead has written Process and Reality. This world shares one crucial feature with all the other, the risk taken in order to exist and to keep on existing. Thus, the hiatus that I had detected very early on in exegesis, that I had found in the study of scientific inscription, in the disjointed itinerary of courses of action, Garfinkel, in the surprising detour of techniques, this same hiatus was here as well, here in the first place, in the apparent continuity of being here. A sort of epiphany came to me. There was nothing inevitable, nothing definitive, nothing irremediable in the tribulation of subject and object. Well, this is what the investigation is really about. I was very interested, starting in 87, to pursue this inquiry, which I've now, of which I've written a summary in French, should be appear in English. This little framework, call it semiotic, philosophy, whatever, could be defined without contradiction either as philosophy, anthropology, or sociology. Before I conclude, it may be useful to recall the influence of his studies on the nature-culture scheme for philosophical anthropology. Not for a moment, I had forgotten the shock of African neocolonialism, of the advance of a modernizing frontier. While I was in Melbourne, I prepared a lengthy review of Chapin and Schaffer's seminal book on Hobson Boyle, Leviathan and the Air Pump, of Cambridge celebrity, to Cambridge, which has just been published. This led, thanks to the work on what I call at the time regime of enunciation, to an outcome in symmetrical anthropology. By providing a realistic description of the sciences at last, I mean, this is my term, yeah, realistic, it's not always accepted. A realistic description of the sciences by showing their equipment, by bringing the chains of reference to the foreground, it became possible to detach the representation of nature both from the work of the sciences and from the movement of beings left to themselves, a movement that Whitehead had taught us to respect and that he called fighting the bifurcation of nature, to use the term he developed into the concept of nature. An anthropology of the modern became possible, one that could transform the nature-culture scheme used up to them by anthropologists, except nature was the uncoded category and only culture was the coded category, as an indispensable resource into a topic that had, on the contrary, to be explored. Now the two categories are coded categories, a large part due actually to feminist studies as well as science studies. Once again, the resource became the topic. The result was not negligible for understanding society, for it made possible to detect the immense abyss between the modernist representation of history, the arrow of time, the modernizing frontier, and the real history, that of an entanglement between human and non-human, without discerning arrows of time, that is ever more intimate and ever larger in scale, which is another way, which find now another term, the Anthropocene. But above all, it opened up with other collectives. Remember, the word collective is here not to use the word society, because it's a collecting activity of agents, agency, human and non-human, the possibility of making comparison at last that would be less biased by the idea of a modernizing frontier capable in the long run of extending to the entire planet. The others are not really modern. Ah, so much the better. We have never been modern and never will be. an entirely different history awaits us. The search for the Parliament of Things 20 years later, it seems to me, has only increased in actuality. Modernize or ecologize, we were going to have to choose. As I saw it, the chief interest of we have never been modern, the negative version of an argument whose positive version I am offering now, is that it initiated a much closer collaboration with anthropologists, the real one, not me, around the ontological pluralism of collectives. It was no longer a matter for Philippe Descola, Eduardo de Castro, Marilyn Strathern, of comparing culture against the background of nature, but of contrasting more and more sharply the ontology, in the plural, the ontologies, which just one, us, and even that is disputable, use the schema of mononaturalism and multiculturalism. Having been a servant of philosophy, anthropology is becoming, if not its master, at least its colleague. By becoming local or regional, ontology, symmetrically, has become correspondingly deeper. For the science of being, which is the old definition of ontology, the science of being has more than one trick up its sleeve, it seems. And the end of the restriction imposed by the notion of symbolic representation of the material world opens up an all the more fertile program of research. Between the science of being as being, the venerable discipline of ontology, and the science of being as other, anthropology, new bonds can be seen. All the more so in that the people Descola sees as naturalist, that's the difficult label that he uses, the white, frenzied users of a nature-culture scheme, in practice do something else entirely, which complicate their description quite a lot. This is not insignificant, since the more and more pressing eruption of ecological question requires us to pay closer and closer attention to the relation between cosmology and science. The singular term cosmology, a property of the exact sciences, and the plural term cosmologies, used in a somewhat casual fashion by anthropologists to describe diverse worldviews, are now converging within an enclosure that has become the new political world at the time of the Anthropocene, that of contemporary cosmopolitics, to use the word of Stengers. In the end, the mystery as to what these moderns have been up to remains intact. What has happened to them? If it's not nature that they have discovered through the fog of their cultures, if it's not reason that has finally shined light into the darkness of representation, what has in fact happened? Of what are they the heirs? This is to answer this question of philosophical anthropology, or regional ontology, another bizarre term, that we need a method that provides an adequate depiction of the situation to be described. This is the argument of the modes of existence. How many sensors do we need to do justice to the value deployed by those who call them modern and who have never been modern? I've been struggling for all these years to identify these senses in the hope that in a lecture like that, I might find some co-investigator to move the argument a bit further. Thank you very much.